Hello, my dear students. Welcome back to my channel. Today, in this video, we are going to learn a class 10 English poem, The Temple and the Body, Vachana's Question and Answers. This poem is written by Basavanna, and the explanation of this poem is already uploaded in my channel, and I'll be sharing the link of the same in the description box for your reference, so that you can go click and refer the explanation of this poem. So today we'll discuss the question and answers of this poem. So let us start. But before that, students, if you are viewing my video for the first time, to subscribe my channel and hit the bell icon so that you get the notification of all the upcoming videos. To watch the video till end, and if you like it, hit the like button and share among your friends. So moving on to the question answers now. We have second main comprehension questions in your textbook. Answer briefly the following questions. Under that first question, the lines "the rich will make temples of Shiva" implies that A, they want to please the Lord, B, they can afford to build temples, C, they believe that this is how they can serve God, and D, they believe that the temple is the only place to feel the presence of God. So answer according to the poem is C. They believe that this is how they can serve God. The students have already learned the poem. We have seen the explanation, so we can easily find out the answer here. Okay, so moving on to the next question. Which of the following statements are true? Again, we have four options. We have to pick out the true statement from this. So A, the speaker is against building any structures for worshiping God. B, it's not possible for the speaker to build a temple. Or C, it's only an excuse given by the speaker for not being able to build a temple. Or D, the speaker believes that God is present within ourselves and not in any temple. So the answer here is D. The speaker believes that God is present within ourselves and not in any temple. Okay. So moving on to the next question. What are the feelings of the speaker suggested in the question, "What shall I, a poor man, do?" A, is it showing helplessness? B, doubt? C, humility? D, anger? E, pride? Or F, anguish? So we see here that for the speaker is suggesting his helplessness. Okay, here we can understand from this line, "What shall I, a poor man, do?" is showing the helplessness of the person, of the speaker. So let's move on to the next question. The word "listen" in the last stanza is an order, an appeal, a request, or an advice. So it can be B, an appeal. Because the poet here is appealing to listen to everyone he requests here. So we can opt for option B, and appeal. So next question. The expression "things standing" suggests any man-made temple, anybody who is standing, anything which is static, or the human body. So again, according to the poem we have seen, we come to know that the answer is A, any man-made temple. Okay, so what are the things standing here according to the poem? If you see, any man-made temple which is there on the earth is a standing thing. So that is what referred here. So let's move on to the next question now. There are two examples of paradox in the last two lines. So what's paradox? A paradox is a statement containing opposite ideas. Okay. So first question under that, what opposite ideas are suggested in "things standing shall fall"? So we are having some opposite idea in this line, in this phrase, "things standing shall fall." So what does it suggest? So "things standing shall fall" refers to man-made temples. They cannot stand forever and will fall and get destroyed one day. Okay, we've already read the poem, we have heard the explanation, we have seen the explanation of the poem, and we come to know that The man-made temples which are here may get destroyed one day, but the inner feeling or the worship from the heart which comes out will never die. That is what is referring here. Things standing shall fall, but if you worship from your heart, it will remain forever. So here the opposite ideas are stand and fall. Okay, so here it is a paradox, and these are the last two lines which gives us this opposite ideas. Moving on to the next sub question. What opposite ideas are suggested in the moving shall ever stay? So again, what are this opposite ideas suggesting in this phrase, the moving shall ever stay? So answer is, the moving, that is the human heart, which is a moving temple, cannot be destroyed by nature's fury, unlike a temple that can be damaged easily by nature. Okay, so here again we see that the moving shell, here the moving is nothing but the human heart from which you worship God from your heart. So it is a moving temple. Okay, your heart, when you move, it moves, your body moves, your heart moves, and it is a moving temple, and it cannot be destroyed by nature's fury, unlike a temple. So here is giving an example that a temple which is built by man, a man-made temple, it can be damaged or destroyed by nature's disaster. It can be flood, it can be storm, it can be any other disaster or fury from the nature's side, and it can easily destroy the nature. But the human heart which is there, it will never get destroyed, and the temple will remain, the heart will remain worshipping till the soul dies and go to the eternal world. Even then the soul is there, and in the soul you can have this worshipness of the God. So this is how they are showing the opposite ideas. Okay, so going on to the next question. What final message do the last two lines convey? So answer, the poet is consoling himself that the temple which he would never be able to construct would any day be destroyed, whereas the moving temple that he carries in his heart would be immortal and intact. Okay, so the final message what we get from this last two lines of this poem is that the poet is trying to console himself. He's trying to just console his heart that even he wanted to build a temple, but he is not able to do that because he is a poor person. He is not able to construct that. But anyhow, he is consoling himself by saying that even if I build a temple here, it would be destroyed any day. If I build from a stone or from some material, and if I stand a temple here on the earth, it can be destroyed. But whereas the moving temple that is there in my heart, which I'm carrying in my heart, it is immortal and it will remain intact. It will not get destroyed nor damaged, and it will be immortal. Even when a person died, the soul will remain immortal, and that is how the moving temple will remain forever and ever. So this is what the final message we get from this poem, that if you just build a temple from stone and materials, it's not going to do with your worshipping, it is going to get destroyed. But if you have that inner feeling and you worship from your heart, that becomes your moving temple, and it is going to remain immortal. Okay, so this is what the very good message which is given in this poem. Let's move on to the next main, close study. Read the following extract carefully, discuss in pairs, and then write the answers to the questions given below it. So students, here we're having an extract from the poem, and based on that extract, we have three questions. So let us see what is it. First one, how is the human body compared to a temple? So when we read the poem, we come to know that the entire human body here is compared to a temple. So how is it done so? So let's see the answer. The legs are compared with the pillars, the body to the shrine, and the head to a cupola of gold. Okay, so here the legs of a human body are compared to the pillars of a temple. The body is compared to the shrine, the statue which is there inside the temple, and the head to a cupola of gold. And the head is the you can say the the headgear which the goddess or god or goddesses have on their head in the temples. If you go, you see that for decoration they have on the head, they wear a good kapola. So that is your head. So like this, the whole human body has been compared to different parts of a temple. Next question, what is the figure of speech used here? So the figure of speech used here is personification. Okay, what is personification? Because here all the human qualities are given to a temple. Temple is a materialistic thing, it's a non-living thing, but here you are giving a human quality, you are comparing it, that there are legs, it is compared with the pillars and this body and the shrine and the head of kapola of gold. So you see that it is personified, that a human quality or the human parts have been compared with the inanimate object. So thus we can write it as personification. Okay, moving on to the next question, why is the speaker comparing the human body to a temple? Okay, why is it comparing like this? So answer is, the speaker wanted to construct a temple like the rich people do and thereby please God, but he is very poor and cannot do so. Hence, he decides to treat his own body as a temple with the God secure in his heart. He also realizes that the temple built of brick and stone can be damaged by nature one day, whereas the moving temple in his heart can never be. Okay, so here very beautifully again the speaker is comparing the human body to a temple, and speaker wanted to construct a temple like all the other rich people do, and he also wanted to please God, but he is so poor that he cannot do so, he cannot afford to build a temple. So he decides that I'll treat my own body as a temple and he'll secure God in his heart. And he also realizes that the temple, if it is built of brick and stone, it can be damaged by nature one day. Any of the disasters can happen, any of the floods, storm, or any fury from the nature side can damage it. But whereas the moving temple which is in my heart can never be damaged because the soul will remain eternal. So this is how very beautifully the speaker has compared the human body to a temple. Okay. Next, the last question of this poem, paragraph writing. You have a long answer here. You have to note it down into important points and then develop into a paragraph. We have directly have written into a paragraph. You can make it into small points. Okay. So the question is, what ideas of spirituality emerge from the study of this well-known vachana? Like, what message is being received by the readers from this well-known vachana? What ideas of spirituality, of the belief what you have on God, do you get from this poem vachana? Okay, so answer is, only the rich can afford to build the temples. But one can really show devotion to God by merely dedicating his body and mind to serve God by making himself into a living temple. A temple built of stone will fall one day, but a living temple can exist forever. Okay, so this is the idea which we get of the spirituality, of the belief of the belief of the God, that only the rich can afford to build the temples here on earth. But if you want to really show your devotion towards God, it's not just that if you build a temple you can show your devotion. No, what you can do is you can dedicate your body and mind to serve God by making yourself as a living temple. And this temple will remain forever. Rather than if you build a stone temple, it is going to fall one day. But your living temple, your heart, your inner worshipping, which you do from your heart, is going to exist forever and ever. And this is what the message we get from this well-known vachana. Okay, students, so with this we come to an end of this question and answer session of this poem. I hope I made it clear with all the question and answers, and if you found this video informative and interesting, do hit the like button and share with your friends. We'll be back soon with more such videos. Till then, stay happy, take care, thank you.